Hello and welcome to the Dittmikes YouTube channel. When I was at junior school or primary school, I always had a fond memory, particularly towards the end of the year when they would say we were going to watch a movie, which was nearly always Charlotte's Web, sometimes Lord of the Rings, the original sort of partially animated version, which I've got to admit baffled me as a child because it made no sense. And later on, I found out the reason why is because that's sort of an amalgamation of many films smashed together and not really finished properly. So there's no surprise there. But what I really remember was the TV being wheeled in on a trolley, a big old CRT TV wheeled in on a trolley. And I also remember that in the assembly hall, occasionally if we were listening to music, a set of speakers were wheeled out on little trolleys of their own. Now, I can't be 100% sure of this because when I was somewhere between 5 and 10 years old, I wouldn't have known one speaker from another, to be honest with you. And I'm pretty sure that they were Spendor BC1s. And the reason I'm mentioning that today is because of this. Those fond memories of speakers on trolleys. Are back. That's a pair of Spendor SP1s. Now, when I was a kid, like most of us, everything was new, exciting, fresh, loads of new experiences to be had, even if they were confusing films. But I've never had a pair of SP1s. I've had SP2s, which share the same bass driver as these, slightly smaller cabinet, two-way design with a scan spec tweeter. I've had SP22s, I've had SP23es, my classic 23s, loads and loads of Spendor speakers over the years, BC1s, but I've never had SP1s. And although the nostalgia of the wheelie trolleys is brilliant, I probably wouldn't recommend using them. In this room, that puts the HF units way too low. So what I'll probably do is take off my Spendor Classic 23s and sit these SP1s on the hi-fi racks, Fortress stands, and we'll have a listen. Okay, we've got a front-ported 2.5-way system here. So this is Spendor's own bass driver, polypropylene, slightly different from the BC one, which was Beckstream, but running the same HF 1300 tweeter from Celestion and the Coles Super Tweeter. So not too dissimilar from the Spendor BC one. Now, as glorious as the BC1 is, and they do sound good, they've got incredible mid-range, phenomenal mid-range. They did have quite a few problems with power handling, bass driver sag. Some people would rotate the bass drivers after a period of time or store the speakers at various different angles just to make sure they didn't get any cone sag. Now, my pair of BC1s were actually okay, and I ran those for several years quite happy with them. But that was many years ago, so those speakers are now another 20-something years old, so whether they're still in spec or not is anyone's guess. But with these, you didn't have those kind of problems. So power handling is up, there's no issues with cone sag, it's a much better or more reliable drive unit. Same configuration, like I said, so Celestion HF1300. That started off life as a GEC, General Electric Company, presence unit. Celestion acquired the tooling and started manufacturing it themselves, calling it the HF1300, because that literally falls off a cliff at 1300. There is nothing left. And the first BC ones actually had the Beckstream cone and just the Celestion tweeter. It was a little while later that the Coles Super Tweeted was added for elevated or extra HF presence. And this being the SP1, so after the BC1, they will all come with this configuration. This configuration or similar configurations has been used in many, many pairs of loudspeakers. There are vast numbers of IMFs, Rogers, Spendors, Bowers & Wilkins, loads of speakers have used a HF1300 and sweep super tweeter combination. Not always the Coles, sometimes it's the KEF T27, sometimes it's Celestion HF2000. But this tweeter, with the addition of a super tweeter, actually gives you a very, very good, complete, decent HF. Very, very nice to listen to. Very pleasant, detailed, crisp. This also actually gives you quite good mid-range characteristics, or the upper end of mid-range, because it's quite a large dome for an HF unit. So we've got two and a half way. It's not a true three-way system. I think, actually, something that I've just thought of when I was talking about the trolleys and not being a fan of them, well, they're still probably not the right height, but what I did notice is this. And they've got a lot of forward and back motion, which is very similar to my Isoacoustics feet. So maybe I've run these down a little bit too early. Maybe I will try these on these trolleys. Maybe they are an incredibly early version of isolation. I doubt it, but we'll try it. I honestly think they are too low for this room. I would personally rather see them on probably 50 centimeter open frame stands, which would bring them approximately to the height of my Spendor Classic 2.3s. I just think that would put the HF at ear level. Plywood box, very lossy cabinet, typical BBC style design. So you've got bituminous panels in there, which are damping out the unwanted resonant frequencies. Quite a large port, which I've got to say, on listening to these, is quite audible. What they did on the SP2 and the SP22 was have a foam roll inside the port, which greatly reduced any port turbulence, thus reducing the actual audible effect of the port. Now that could be, and this does all come down to placement, it could be that on those stands, they're actually too high. And that's why I'm able to hear the port. I'm now going to try them on these stands and see if it makes any difference. I mean, it wasn't horrific, but you could definitely hear the port. And that's something I'm not used to on a lot of the more modern speakers that I've used recently. The port chuffing has just been sorted out. The ports, for argument's sake, on mine are flared. And they're nowhere near as big either. So some serious investigation and work has been put into port tuning over the years. And it, like I said, Spendor even tried to address it themselves by putting a roll of foam in there. I'm not sure if it's supposed to be in there. I'm probably going to have to look that up. Spendor SP1s are a bit of a mystery to me. I've never, ever had a pair. But I'm quite looking forward to listening to a set properly. I've literally just demoed them to check they work okay. And the first thing I did notice was a little bit of port chuffing, but that's the only negative. In terms of HF, wow, really, really detailed speaker. Very reminiscent of my SP2s, but probably even a little bit more crisp and much better in the mid-range. Really, really enjoy the mid-range characteristics of these loudspeakers. So what I'm going to do is give them a try on these perhaps early isolation stands and see what they sound like. Okay, I'm going to play a piece of music and see if any of the tonal characteristics of these speakers come through. It's not ideal doing it like this, but it does give you some idea, I suppose, of what they sound like. I have discovered that these actually do sound better on these stands in this room than they do on my hi-fi rack stands. That's putting them too high, and I made a mistake in the earlier clip. I said 50 centimeter stands, I meant 30 centimeter stands. Approximately 12 inch high stands would probably put them at the correct height for this room. But I've got to say that these sort of rudimentary isolation trolleys seem to be doing the job, because the bass is not ridiculously overblown and none of that port issue is really present with them at this height. So I think that's possibly down to the fact that listening to them on these stands is just too high. And it is very important, stand height. Some loudspeakers have absolutely dedicated stands that if you play about with that stand height, you're actually changing what the designer intended them to sound like. I'm not sure if these were absolutely designed with these trolleys in mind, who knows. But they sound pretty good in this room on them. So we'll play this clip and see what you guys think. Thank you. Okay, as with most decent vintage speakers, they're an absolute delight to listen to. They are full of character, full of life, possibly full of coloration, but that's not always a bad thing. It's musical, joyous, very pleasant to listen to, in no way offensive. It's not shouty, it's not overly bright, it's not overly boomy. They've got a really nice tonal balance to them. I think Spendor really done a great job on these. They sound very different to mine, but there's many years difference between the two. These are like 2017, and I can't remember when SP1s first came out, but it was many, many years ago. It's got to be late 70s, early 80s, I should imagine. But of all of the vintage speakers I've heard over the years, I've got to say these hail way up there. They're very, very pleasant to listen to. The only issues I have found, and this is across the board with a lot of vintage speakers, to be honest with you, is if you put modern digital music in a digital format and play it with any real sort of intent, then these do tend to pull out some of the digital nastiness. And that's not a fault of the speakers. They were designed in an era where digital really was either in its infancy or didn't exist. So taking that into consideration, if you were running these on analog like I am now, or running them on valves, that would be period sort of correct, if you like, and they would sound at their best. However, if you play that digital modern music, I've tried things like Deadmau5, Bonobo, so on and so on, they're just a little bit, they're just pushed to their extreme, which isn't horrible to listen to, but isn't as pleasant as potentially some of the more modern speakers that I've had here recently can sound. And that is just a telltale sign of the age. It would be a bit like vintage cars. There's always a good analogy with vintage cars, classic cars versus modern cars. Something like an E-Type Jag is going to be a glorious thing to look at. It's going to be a glorious thing to sit in. You're going to be very proud of owning one, and you probably enjoy driving. It's probably quite an exciting drive if you can get over the fact they're very hard to change gear. But if you took that on a racetrack and compared that to something that was probably not in the same league as that was back in the day, you would find it very difficult to keep up. The modern car is just going to handle better, brake quicker, be more economical, so on and so on. And it's a similar tale with loudspeakers, that the modern loudspeaker, some of which don't sound as engaging or as musical or as lively as these, but in certain aspects, they are better. They're better at the digital side of things, the more demanding music. But that doesn't necessarily mean they sound better across the board. It's just in that direction. So if you put something period specific on these, they sound absolutely fantastic. Brilliant, brilliant pair of speakers. I really have enjoyed listening to these SP1s. I enjoyed my SP2s and my SP22s as well. They are very, very good speakers from that Derek Hughes era of Spendor. Anyway, take care, guys. That's the Didn't Works video for today. I hope you've enjoyed it. Take care, and I'll catch up with you soon.